Good morning, everyone. Now we are dealing with access to justice and women. The structure of the presentation goes like this. First, we will be looking at women as a vulnerable group. After that, we will look into various international instruments that were adopted by various countries for the purpose of protecting the women from discrimination. And then we will come to the national level, how the constitution has protected the status of women. After discussing the constitution, we will look into women specific legislations, some of them important of them which try to protect the women's rights. After that, we will look into how these legislations give special protections to the women, and then we will see how women can redress their grievances before special mechanisms. So this is how the today's presentation would go. To start with, women as a vulnerable group. If you look at the historically or mythologically, if you put it properly, woman is glorified as a goddess, and even Manushruti says, Yatra Naryastu Pujyante Ramante Tatra Devata. It means where women are honored, their divinity blossoms. So there are enough evidences to show historically women enjoyed freedom, and mythologically women enjoys a higher place. And the examples of these Swayamvara system, for example, Damayanti and Shakuntala, shows the freedom that was given to the women, or the freedom that is enjoyed by the women in choosing their husbands, is very evident. However, biological, political, economical and religious reasons, the status of women slowly declined. So therefore, what they enjoyed as a higher status historically, mythologically, slowly started to degrade, and women became a vulnerable group, subjected to harassment, sexual abuse and discrimination. Therefore, there is an international efforts were made for the purpose of improving the status of women. So we will look into various international instruments that try to protect the women rights. To start with, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which we usually call as UDHR, which were adopted in 1948, talks about equal rights of men and women. The UDHR is actually not women specific. The convention is basically talking about the general rights for the human beings. That is why, apart from that equal rights for men and women, there are no specific provision exclusively for women. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which came into existence in 1976, again talks about equal rights for men and women. Apart from that, Article 6 and 23 exclusively dealing with the rights of the women, particularly talking about the marriageable age. Similarly, the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights in 1976, specifically the Article 7 talks about equal pay for equal work for both men and women. However, there are in 1954, there is a specific convention that was adopted on the political rights of the women. It recognizes three basic political rights for the women. The first right is right to vote, and second one is right to contest in elections, and third one, holding public office. So 1954 convention basically looking at the political rights of the women, and the signatories of this convention, the countries are supposed to ensure these three basic political rights to the women. In 1974, a new convention was adopted, that is the Declaration on Protection of Women and Children in Emergency and Armed Conflict. So, this convention specifically look into the status of women during the armed conflict and emergency. This convention prohibits bombings, especially on women and children. It also prohibits the use of bacteriological weapons against women, and also talks about sparing women from the ravages of war. It also prohibits inhuman treatment for women, and also specifically tells that there should be no deprivation of shelter, food, medical aid, and other inalienable rights for women. However, this convention is focus is very narrow. It only talks in terms of emergency and armed conflict. But in 1979, a comprehensive convention was passed on discrimination against women, which is known as Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, popularly called as CEDAW. It is termed as an International Bill of Rights for Women. It prohibits any distinction, exclusion, or restriction made on the basis of sex. Now, the CEDAW 1979 makes that all the signatories agrees to incorporate the principles of equality for both men and women, and also the countries are supposed to bring laws that prohibit discrimination, and also they are supposed to adopt the laws prohibiting discrimination, abolish discriminatory laws, and also establish the tribunals and other institutions for the purpose of protection of women against the discrimination. It also ensures that elimination of all acts of discrimination by persons, organizations, or enterprises has to be taken care by the concerned states. So, these are some of the international efforts that were made for the purpose of protection of the women, particularly trying to protect from the discrimination. When it comes to the Constitution of India, the preamble clearly establishes that it shall be the duty of the Constitution to secure all its citizens equality of status and opportunity. So, the equality of status and opportunity includes the equality and of status and opportunity for women. However, there are specific fundamental rights deals with the aspect of equality. Article 14 of the Constitution provides that the state shall not deny any person equality before law or equal protection of the laws. So, any person also includes women. In that sense, it ensures that all the laws are non-discriminatory. But the Constitution, Article 15, Clause 1, specifically prohibits the discrimination against any citizen on grounds of sex, among other things. That means, the state cannot discriminate between men and women. But the constitutional protection is not restricted only in prohibiting the discrimination, but also providing a positive provisions under Article 15, Clause 1. For example, Article 15, Clause 3 enables the state to make special provisions for women. So, the difference between 15 clause 1 and 15 clause 3 is that under 15 clause 1, state cannot discriminate women on the basis of sex, whereas 15 clause 3, government or the state can provide special provisions for women in discriminating men. That means, benefits can be given to the women, but a law cannot discriminate the women. Similarly, 16 clause 1 provides or guarantees equality of opportunity in public employment. The Directive Principles of State Policy, Article 39A, specifically says that it shall be the duty of the state to ensure equal opportunities to acquire means of livelihood for men as well as women. And similarly, 39 Clause D also talks about the state's obligation to provide equal pay for equal work. And Article 42 says that the state should make provisions for maternity leave. 73rd and 74th amendments to the Constitution provides reservations for women in panchayats and municipalities. So, this is what the constitution specifically provides for the protection of the women, and we shall now look into how the judiciary in India interpreted the provisions in ensuring equality and also prohibiting the discrimination against women. In Ranadhir Singh versus Union of India, the Supreme Court brought equal pay for equal work, which is a directive principle, as a part of fundamental right under Article 14. Similarly, in Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan, the Supreme Court prescribed several guidelines while prohibiting sexual harassment at workplace. In Railway Board versus Chandrima Das, the Supreme Court said that even a foreign woman who was raped by the railway authorities is entitled for a compensation under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. In Air India versus Nargish Mirza, the Supreme Court struck down the discriminatory laws which are degrading the women under Air India rules. In Sheila Barse versus State of Maharashtra, the Supreme Court has given lengthy guidelines regarding arrest of women and interrogation of the women who are accused of crimes. It says that at least 4 or 5 police lockups should be selected in reasonably good localities where only female suspects should be kept, and they should be guarded by the female constables. And it also says that the female suspect cannot be kept in a police lockup where the males are also detained. And the interrogation of the females should be carried out only in the presence of a female constables or police officers. Similarly, in Delhi domestic workers women's case, the Supreme Court says that the complaints of sexual assault cases, the women should be provided legal representation, and such legal assistance must start at the police station itself, and the police should inform the victim that she has such a right to consult a lawyer before any questions asked by the police. That means the providing legal representation not at the time of trial, but even at the time of investigation is secured under this case. And a list of advocates who are willing to provide such an assistance should be kept in the police station. Further, the Supreme Court also says all rape trials, anonymity of the victim must be maintained. And the Supreme Court also directed that a criminal injuries compensation board must be established, and compensation for the victim shall be awarded by the court on conviction of the offender. In State of Maharashtra versus Madhukar Narain, the Supreme Court said that a woman of easy virtue is entitled for privacy, and on the name of women of easy virtue, the state cannot take away her privacy. And in addition to these judgments, there are many other important rulings. For example, the question on whether a DNA testing can be done without the wife consent for the purpose of identifying whether the child belonging to the father or not. The court said that a paternity test by doing a DNA testing cannot be conducted without the wife's consent. And the Supreme Court in another important judgment held that the second marriage by a Hindu husband who converted into Islam without the consent of the wife would be liable for bigamy. And Supreme Court and the court is also struck down certain provisions of Indian Divorce Act, which treats different grounds for the husband and wife for claiming divorce as violation of equality. So, it is very clear that the constitution had several provisions to protect the women, and the Supreme Court is liberal in interpreting these provisions for the purpose of protecting women. And in addition to that, there are Number of women specific legislations, however, all the lists are not possible to be presented here. Therefore, some important legislations were given here. And we will now look into what is the special protection provided for the women. To start with, under Criminal Procedure Code, the Criminal Procedure Code gives protection to the woman in the process of arrest. And according to Section 46, women cannot be arrested after sunset and before sunrise. That means a woman cannot be arrested during night. In case of serious offenses, a written remote report has to be submitted to the judicial magistrate first class, with whose prior permission a woman police officer may cause the arrest. However, in case of suspected female to be searched, only a woman constable can do so under Section 100. Similarly, the interrogation of a woman cannot be called at the police station. Interrogation has to be carried out at the place where the woman resides. The identity of a woman has to be protected in cases of sexual offenses. The second provision that we are looking at for the protection of women is the legal aid entitlement. Under the Legal Services Authorities Act 1987, Section 12 provides that all women are entitled for free legal aid. So, all women means women belonging to any economic strata is automatically entitled to claim legal aid under Legal Services Authorities Act. Similarly, there are family courts which were established specifically to deal with all personal matters like marriages, divorce, maintenance and child custody. So, now let us come to the last one on grievance redressal mechanism. Now, this grievance redressal mechanism we will be looking under regular criminal courts and under different laws. Under the regular criminal courts, once an offense against women was taken place, they cover under Indian Penal Code. These offenses are redressable through the regular criminal court like judicial magistrate, first class, sessions court, high court and supreme court. In Sakshi versus Union of India, the Supreme Court said that in trial of sexual abuse or rape, the proceedings must be in camera. The requirement of a screen or any other arrangement where the victim or the witness will not be able to see the face or body of the accused is necessary, because many times the victim or the witness who has to see the face or body of the accused may lead to the further trauma and fear during the deposition of their statements. The domestic violence. In case of domestic violence, under the Domestic Violence Act, the Domestic Violence Act recognizes four kinds of domestic violence. The first one is physical abuse, where any kind of a torture, a physical torture like burning, beating, scaling, etc. is prohibited. The second kind of domestic violence is the verbal and emotional abuse, where any family member verbally or emotionally abuses a woman, it would be a wrong under the Domestic Violence Act. And the third one is a sexual abuse, and the fourth one is economic abuse. Under the economic abuse, not giving money to the wife or the woman would amount to economic abuse. So, the remedies under the Domestic Violence Act are as follows. Once a domestic violence takes place, the woman is entitled for a protection order, and she also can claim monetary and compensatory relief from the family members. She is entitled for medical aid, and she also can claim temporary shelter from the state. In addition to that, she has a right to reside in the household. That means, if the husband who is abusive, and when the wife files a case under Domestic Violence Act, husband cannot driven away his wife because she filed a case. She has a right under the act to reside in the same house. She also have right to maintenance during this time, and she also have a right to custody of the children, and she has a right to claim injunction against the perpetrator. Once it amounts to a domestic violence, the complaint can be made to any one of the following officers. First, you can make a complaint to a police officer or a protection officer who was appointed under the act, or a service provider recognized by the act, or any magistrate having a jurisdiction could be approached. So, anyone among these four are allowed to be approached by a woman. And regarding the filing a complaint, this complaint could be either filed by the woman who suffered the violence, or the victim's relatives, or even the neighbors who have an information, or any other social worker. That means, under the Domestic Violence Act, the complaint not necessarily filed by the victim herself, but any other person who had a knowledge of such abuse could file a case. The second important act that we are looking at is the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Redressal and Prohibition Act 2013. Now, before this act, in Vishakha case, the Supreme Court already held that any sexual harassment at workplace would amount to violation both under Article 14, 16 and 21, and has given an exhaustive definition of what is sexual harassment, and also insisted all the government and non-governmental institutions shall set up a committee against sexual harassment. However, a need was felt by the government that there is a need for a comprehensive legislation to deal with sexual harassment. So, under this Act 2013, the definition of the sexual harassment seems to be taken exactly from what the Supreme Court has given in Vishakha's case. So, according to this act, sexual harassment means and includes such unwelcome sexually determined behavior, such as it has given the list. Number one, physical contact and advances. That means, any unwelcome sexual behavior of physical contact or any advance amounts to sexual harassment. Similarly, any demand or request for sexual favors also amounts to sexual harassment. Not only demanding, but even sexually colored remarks. So, even cracking jokes, making certain remarks which were sexually colored would amounts to sexual harassment. Further, showing of any pornography or pornographic pictures or videos would amounts to sexual harassment. Similarly, making sexual demands amounts to sexual harassment, but the sexual demands were further divided into five categories. One is physical demand, verbal demand, third one is textual demand, fourth one is graphic demand, and fourth one is electronic demand. That means, even sending SMS or emails soliciting sexual favors would amounts to sexual harassment. In case of sexual harassment, the complaint can be given by an aggrieved woman to internal complaints committee in writing. So, according to the act, every institution should have an internal complaints committee. And if an institution does not have an internal complaints committee, the complaint can be made to the local complaint committee. After receiving the complaint, the committee conducts the inquiry. During the pendency of the inquiry, the victim is entitled to the following measures. First, woman may request her transfer from that department to another department. So, this transfer, either she can ask for her transfer or she can ask the perpetrator's transfer. Second one, she may be granted leave for 3 months during the pendency. Third one, she can seek any other appropriate relief. And the final report must be sent to the employer or a district officer. While submitting the report, the committee may recommend any one of the following. The first one, action according to service rules if the perpetrator was found guilty. So, that may include termination of the services, etc. Second, deduct the salary to be paid to the aggrieved woman. That means a salary could be deducted from the perpetrator and pay that salary to the aggrieved woman. And the inquiry has to be completed within 90 days. So, it is a time bound inquiry, the inquiry cannot drag on. Now, coming to the commissions, there is a National Women Commission Act in 1990. Under the National Women Commission Act 1990, a National Commission for Women was set up as a statutory body in January. This commission was established for the purpose of reviewing the constitutional and legal safeguards for women. It also have a power to recommend remedial legislative measures. It could facilitate redressal of grievances and also advise the government on policy matters affecting the women. In addition to that, in case of any abuse on women, complaints also can be made against the National Commission for Women, and these complaints can be made even orally or in writing. However, if the complaint is in writing, it may be addressed to the commission or its chairperson or any members or any other officer of the commission. All such complaints received by the complainant or a investigating cell, after receiving such a complaint, it has to be entered in a complaint register and the investigation cell will investigating into the matter. It comes to the powers of the commission. The commission has a power to recommend the concerned government or authority to initiate the proceedings again for prosecution or action on the person. It also can recommend to the concerned government for grant of such immediate relief to the victim or the members of the victim's family. It could also further recommend to the authority to grant such immediate relief to the victim or the members of his family as the commission may consider necessary. The another important aspect of protection of women is maintenance. Now, right to claim maintenance either from the husband or other relatives are well recognized under the personal laws of different religions. A woman has no income of her own and cannot maintain herself, can make the application for maintenance. So, the maintenance application can be made both under the personal law or under criminal procedure code. If the application was made under the personal law, it has to be made before the district court having the jurisdiction over family matters. Or where a family court is existing, in such a case, instead of district court, it should be before the family court. So, when it comes to maintenance under criminal procedure code, section 125 of CRPC provides maintenance, and a maintenance application must be made before the judicial magistrate first class. So, there are sufficient number of legislations were passed for the purpose of protection of women in addition to the constitutional protection. However, if you look at the constitutional protection, The constitutional protection usually extend in the public life. There is no such provision in the private life. That means, if the state violates the rights, then there would be a violation of the constitution, but if a person or a private person violates, there is no such protection. For example, if the state discriminates the women in employment or education, it is an actionable wrong against the state under the constitution. However, if a father violates the similar right, there is no protection under fundamental rights. So, therefore, the protection of the rights of the woman, though sufficient constitutional and statutory protections are available, it is also the mindset of the society that need to change for the purpose of protecting the women's rights. Thank you.